afternoon. We've already had a tremendous riches, words and music, hard to follow, but it really is a great privilege to be invited along. Let me introduce you to Mother Bird and Father Bird, and these are my elderly parents as birds. First, my mother. Mother Bird can't fly. Mother Bird on my back, I cope uncertainly with the liftoff. Upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, up, up, up. She is all wing bone, all weighty fragility. It's years now since she soared into the sky. But it's not the same sky, she calls out. Where are we? The energy it takes to stay up here with her, to hover. Careful, she cries, ever fearful for her life. Look out, don't fly into the sun, don't stall, don't stop, don't even. The wind snatches her voice. There's no route, no narrative or plot. The sky has no end, but we're near the end of somewhere. Keep steady, she commands. I visit my mother. Mother bird. A big blowsy bird in the nest. The V of her beak wide open to receive all that I stop by to drop in. Torn twigs are rough pricking. The nest floor is mossy and tender. I let tasty bits fall into her mouth, one after the other after the other. She can only digest little pieces, broken off the larger offerings. Sometimes there isn't a part of her that isn't sore. Rain makes the place uninhabitable. The sun tries to dry it. It's surprising what she fits into a nest when I think she alone would fill it. Her head droops to her breast, her eyes close. Mother bird in her circular home, her stick propped against the woven wall. Birds again, but here I'm thinking of the cold winter when my Pakistani father first arrived in England. He used to talk about a freezing trip to Bridlington. The coldest winter. Father bird perched on the country's frozen edge. England. Bridlington Bay. He glanced from side to side. The wind blew away each glance. The sea with its iron grey stretch of thought. Surely the sea would freeze. Father bird, and a second bird, and a third. It's an opportunity for us. Then we can return. The sand was a field of snow, strewn with the sea's chill gifts. They'd flown with the valued cargo of themselves, lightweight but strong, fluffed up their feathers for warmth. It was their choice. The sky was a country of its own. All around them, the seabirds wheeled and cried and laughed. And more recently, departed father or father bird died. But there's a photo. A photo of father bird. We don't speak of him very much, though in his frame he sings and sings, "Here I am, here I am." He perches just above life, handsome, brown feathered, a migrant, so many birds rolled into one. We're shaken, the treetop is swaying in a gale. Father bird stabs and stabs at the living world, and he's almost broken through. "Welcome," we say to him, "welcome back." "I am ever present," he sings. "I can't come back." As quite a few birds run through this bit of the reading, I thought I'd slip a dog in. We did have a very nice dog earlier with a nice face from Catherine. This is my version of a poem by the poet Geoffrey referred to, French Uruguayan poet Jules Supervielle. His dates were 1884 to 1960. And I was drawn amongst other things, such as his two countries, to his gently fantastical style, the dog. "I'm a stray, a wandering dog. That's all I know, except when a voice falls on me from above. A poet's voice that singles me out for a special treat. I've no speech of my own, only a bark to clear my throat, light my way through the fog. I've no wish to be freed from my darkness, want nothing to do with a head full of words dropped on me by a stranger. I'm a stray, a wandering dog. Ask nothing more of me." I like the idea of the bark being to clear his throat. As a child, I read stories, and maybe we all did, that are not great literature, but nevertheless they stay with us. And then conversely, as an adult, reading great literature supposedly doesn't stay with you at all. But this is one of those childhood stories. Chinese story. I remember it and don't remember it. The wooden bird cages. The bird catcher who took the bright birds backwards and forwards to the market in a handcart. They were so alive and sweet singing in their cages. Then something happened. It pains me that I can't recall exactly what. There was certainly conflict, an argument, and I'm sure a second birdman was involved. At some point, the birds were probably freed to encircle the heads of the bird catchers in a yellow, white, and red conflagration. The tail was sunny, and how could it have been so full of light if they were never freed? But who knows? It wasn't a celebrated story like The Emperor and the Nightingale, and I may never trace it, but it still flickers, the colours of the birds accented by distance. I can see the town's network of bleached lanes, the birdcatchers' pointed straw hats, and the thin black tendrils of their moustaches. I know that little needs to happen in the story, as long as it resonates, and this one does, with its intimation of China. The birds were the story's active soul, the cages almost as lovely as they were, tiered and decorative like crowded palaces. As for the people, there were just so many as could comfortably fit inside a story. With our daughter leaving home to go to university and me thinking about birds, I couldn't resist the idea of the empty nest. And in a way, I do think there's nothing that looks as empty as the abandoned bird's nest. I've decided it's because they don't have any furniture. Because if reading Beatrix Potter, you rather expect there to be something in there. And then there's the shock of the utter emptiness, the empty nest. The sun slips through, the bowl is warmed. You can't quite call it empty when there's air in it, and still more air. Wedged in a fork of the apple tree, it's in no danger of falling. A simple room, it looked so small and humble, though actually it's a masterwork, refined with a velvety floor. The wind blows unevenly, and once we heard it howl, they've gone. No one saw them leave, asked them how they fared, or where they were heading. We suppose their wings were streaked with enthusiasm. Is there really such a thing as a new life? After all, we've each been allocated just one. But then sometimes we're sure that a different version has shaken us up and claimed us. What can we drop in here? A strip of foil, a piece of shell, invited, uninvited, something will move in. My father's last words to me, less, much less. He hardly spoke any words, only two, or you could call it one. The last thing he said was bye-bye. Flight feathers, veined and hair-like, with interlocking barbules of sound. The bye-bye trapped a breath of air. The two linked words drifted out on a calm lake that lay there with a single purpose, to receive final words and allow them to drift on its surface, out and further out, on the lake of thought and composure, encircled by mountains. The simple phrase soared upwards to the highest peak, where it would be planted like a flag, would eventually be enshrined, each identical word carefully balanced either side of the invisible join. Like baby talk, he put equal emphasis on each word. His face was pinched and his bird beak very prominent. There have never been two joined words with so much space around them. Pack up all my cares and woes, like the light. I'll arrive late tonight. Blackbird, bye-bye, bye. Small pause there. And now for my father's country, which was India, as he knew it, but then became Pakistan, which was where I was born. And here we're going back to 1947, the partition of India and the creation of Pakistan. My grandmother, who was a widow at the time and a Muslim, made the crossing from Ludhiana in India to Lahore in the new Pakistan with five of her children. And Hindus would have been making the crossing in the other direction, a kind of mass exodus. And during the crossing, her eldest son, Atta, who'd suffered brain damage as a result of a childhood accident, disappeared, never to be found again. And this was the fate of many vulnerable children and adults. I only found out about this missing uncle fairly recently, because I think it was partly the tragedy of his loss and partly the point of shame of having someone in your family with brain damage, you know, in those days. And I felt that he'd been written out of history, so I felt the desire to write him back in. I'll read some extracts from this book-length poem in 20 sections. And before I do, I'd like to thank you all very much for coming. I know some of you from quite some distances to listen to all of us, and it's much appreciated. So beginning here with the line of partition in India, so arbitrarily drawn up by Sir Cyril Radcliffe, the lawyer who was invited in to do this. He'd never been to India before. He didn't know anything about the country, so he was considered ideal for the job. He did it as fast as he was able, in the time it takes to sort out a school timetable. A line so delicate a sparrow might have picked it up in its beak. Not an artist's line or a line of writing. A line between birth and non-being. A line that would mean death for so many. The land itself, at its calmest and most dignified, yielded to the line, lay still, didn't know what was coming. India and Pakistan, the countries required their boundaries as the thirsty needed water, the beggars their begging bowls. The line was its own religion. It seemed to have its own god. It sliced through a village, cut a house in half. Where to place it in all of reality? This is going towards the middle of the book. My grandmother and her family spent some months in a refugee camp outside Lahore, waiting to be rehoused. And Atta, the son who was lost, had been entrusted to friends and family to make the journey, and I imagine that it was here that she might have found out, might have been here she found out that he was missing. Holes in shelters, holes in families, the losses trickled out, poured out, in the queues, in huddles around the fire. Father handed his wallet over. Somebody hit him. He bled to death. Her eyes are sunken. Her hands withered. A fishy smell. The doctor says it's cholera. Losses mounting on losses. And the good fortune. They warned us. They hid us. Those angels sent from Allah. The housing project. Any news? Any news? They demanded of each other, of the police guards, of the overarching sky. Time flowered, flowered and died. And now, having come so far, I'll press on, as she couldn't press on. And imagine it was here she found out, indelibly here. "We're sorry," they said, "the friends of friends. So very sorry. He isn't with us. Disappeared at. He vanished between. The last time we saw him, we did what we could. Sorry, we're so very sorry." And at dusk, his name sounded in the mile-long roll call of the missing. Brothers, sons, aunts, fathers, daughters, especially daughters, missing. Divas, Daras, Kashibas, Kalsums, Bakiris, Myras, Baharas, Yasminas, Maroons, daughters, missing, and utter missing. And there was forever someone who thought they'd seen them or knew someone, had a brother or an uncle or a mother-in-law who had seen or had heard something, seen utter or someone just like him. So you thought you saw him. Where? Tell me again. Why did I? Why didn't they? A young man so doubly lost, knowing no better. Had he wandered off? Would people be kind? The darkness fell, swooped, as darkness does. This is, again, fast-forwarding. Utter is still missing. The family is eventually rehoused in Lahore, a house that would have been vacated by a Hindu or Sikh family who would have made the crossing in the other direction. So this is part 15, and now. Brother, brother in England, sister, 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 mother. The family began to reconfigure around an absence, the ripeness of his loss, ripe as if some fruit must fall, but hour by hour, month by month, no fruit fell. No fruit, but the offer of a house or part of one, not like for like, the building shared. No veranda, no garden with hibiscus in a border, no almond trees. A house neither old nor new, tucked away behind the bazaar, leaning into a yellow courtyard, its entrance on a narrow lane. "Amma, this will do. Acha, acha. Yes, this will do." They move like trespassers through the rooms of orphaned furniture, claim chests of drawers, the shelves of the almirahs, remove saris and underskirts, sleeveless pullovers, shirts, shawars, and replace them with their own. Tried all the beds, were they softer, harder? Inspected the kitchen, the bags of lentils, flour, opened and unopened, the tubber in place on the stove, waiting for the moons of roti. And they noted in the darkened living room the number and position of chairs. Everything as it was when a family, mirroring their own, had grasped the future and fled. Thank you very much.